I have a favor to ask of you. If you are using your phones and you're able to connect to internet and through Twitter, through your data plans, we're asking you to do that rather than do it through the server here, rather than do it through Wi-Fi, because apparently we're all so excited and so, you know, just using everything that the system is shutting down on us. So if you have your data plan, use that and not sign on to Wi-Fi at MIST. Okay? All right. This is a nation of a panel, as you can see. nation of scholars devoted to Black girls. I'm going to introduce our panel's moderator, who, as with all the moderators, are members of our planning committee, hardworking planning committee, and then she will introduce our panelists. Dr. Carla Shedd is my colleague, my beloved colleague. She is an assistant professor of sociology and African American studies at Columbia University. She received her PhD in sociology from Northwestern University. Her research and teaching interests focus on crime and criminal justice, race and ethnicity, law, inequality, and urban sociology. Her first book, which is available at the book table out there, is titled Unequal City, Race, Schools, and Perceptions of Injustice, and it was just published last year. It focuses on Chicago public school students and is an extremely timely examination of race, place, education, and the expansion of the American carceral state. Her current research focuses on New York City's juvenile justice system, investigating how young people's linked institutional experiences influence their placement on and movement along the carceral continuum. So please join me in welcoming the brilliant Carla Shedd, who will introduce our panel.
Thank you to the brilliant Farrah J. Griffin. When she told the Black girls to get in formation, she did it. She did it before Beyonce did, but in the same spirit. And here we are, in formation, ready. So I am so pleased to share with you today and to bring you seven brilliant minds that have been doing research and writing on Black girls. And so we are thinking of this moment as a way for you to see the highlights of the work that they've done, to engage them. We have some index cards which will be passed around for you to jot your questions down, and I'll try to go through those as we go through the Q&A. But we really want to activate all this brilliance because, as you know, we've talked about Black girls and where they exist, and we're often at the margins, whether we're scholars or perhaps in other venues. But for a Black scholar who is a woman to also do research on Black girls, you're even more at the margins. And so I'm delighted to know that we can center this amazing work, we can bring it to the fore, and we can open it up and think about the next directions. There's so much to be done, as we can tell from what was shared with us on the first panel. So I'm ready to see like what the research agenda will be after we share with you, and then you tell us where the next steps are that we should go. So to my far, far left, I have Dr. Marcia Chatelain from Georgetown University. She spent her girlhood in Chicago, Illinois, and it helped her to make it through her undergraduate work at the University of Missouri and inspired her PhD research at Brown University. She experiences hashtag Black Girl Magic while working as an associate professor of history and African American studies at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. Next to Dr. Marcia, we have Dr. Aimee Meredith Cox. Yes. She is a cultural anthropologist, a movement artist, who is currently the associate chair of African and African American studies at Fordham University. Aimee's first book, released in August, last August, on Duke University Press, is Shapeshifters, Black Girls and the Choreography of Citizenship. Next to Aimee, we have Dr. Ruth Nicole Brown. So hot. She is the visionary of saving our lives, hear our truths. She works as an associate professor of gender and women's studies and educational policy organization and leadership at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. Next to her is Dr. Andreana Clay. She is associate professor and chair of the departments of sociology and sexuality studies at San Francisco State University. Her research interests lay at the intersection of race, queerness, Black popular culture, and social movements. Next, we have Dr. Lakeisha Simmons. She is assistant professor of gender studies at the University of Buffalo, CUNY. Her research and teaching focuses on the history of Black girls and on Black motherhood. She is co-organizing a conference on the global history of Black girls at the University of Virginia, so mark your calendars for March 2017 and look for the call for papers. Talk about a research agenda moving forward. And last but not least, we have Dr. Kyra Gaunt, who is currently teaching at Baruch College at the City University of New York. Dr. Kyra is the author of the prize-winning book, The Games Black Girls Play, Learning the Ropes from Double Dutch to Hip Hop, published by New York University Press. She studies the role of music and technology at the intersections of race, gender, and sexuality, particularly concerning sexploitation and childhood privacy issues on YouTube. Yes, warm welcome to all of this brilliance. Dr. Toya, Dr. Toya, she is an associate professor of criminal justice and criminology at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. Her research focuses broadly on the influence of race, gender, and class inequalities on crime and justice-related outcomes and has been published in various edited books and numerous peer-reviewed journals. Dr. Toya. I am just ready to get to the brilliance. So I have asked our wonderful panelists to curate their brilliance to make sure that we have, you know, enough time to really get to the amazing work that they have done. And what I want to ask of a couple of panelists first is to build on what we talked about in the first panel and think about the ways in which research has changed and the ways in which the lives of Black girls have changed across the years. So to my two historians that are on this panel, Marcia, Lakeisha, how have the experiences of Black girls and society's view of them changed in recent decades?
I'm afraid that they haven't changed as much as I need them to. The one thing that I will say is that there is now a language in which Black girls can articulate their frustration with the mixed messages that they receive about what is possible and what is actually going to happen. And so I think that when I look at the girls I studied during the Great Migration, they were keenly aware that they had been sold a bill of goods. The migration wasn't changing anything for them. And at the same time, they now had these new forms in a large urban area like Chicago in which to express that. And I think that that's what we're seeing now. Hmm.
Lakeisha, how might you respond?
I think I write about Black girls who grew up during Jim Crow segregation in the South. And when I was writing, I was thinking very much that I was writing about a time in the past that had changed a lot. And it was after I finished the book that Dujeria Becton got attacked by the police officer at a swimming pool. And I realized that things hadn't really changed as much as I was assuming when I was writing my book. And to me, that was really, really scary. I think that I would maybe name two moments of change that have been really important. One is in the late 60s and in the 1970s with Black Power and what that Black is Beautiful has meant to Black women in that period, but also the ways in which it gave Black women a language to be proud of who they were and what they look like. I think we're in another moment right now of change, and it's yet to see what's going to happen, but I feel a sea change kind of in the wind, and when I look at young women and girls and the kinds of work they're doing now, mm-hmm. so.
And what exactly might we think of as the openings for studying Black girls? What are the political openings? What are the social openings? And to Dr. Kyra Gaunt, I want to ask, what are the cultural openings for studying the lives and experiences of Black girls?
Good afternoon. Mm-hmm. I need a little more mic over here. So I'm just going to... Good afternoon. I want to say hi to the crowd over there. I know you all don't... Hey. And over there.
Hey.
We often see the people here. So first of all, I want to thank everybody for coming. So the cultural...
openings for studying Black girls.
I don't know about for everybody else, but I think for me, the cultural opening is that the play and the music and the body of Black girlness was not present in the research for me as a... I was a student of music. I'm a classically trained singer. I sing jazz and R&B, and most of the things that I understand about rhythm and music and the body come from my experiences around Black girls' musical play. And so the cultural opening was to think about, in fact, it started when I was doing my graduate work at University of Michigan, and two twin girls, I think they were 7 at the time, were playing slide, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And I was talking at a conference and I heard them in the background and I thought, well, the beats and rhymes that we listen to in hip hop, those are the same beats and rhymes. And until I met a sister at Columbia, I gave a talk that Manning Marable invited me, or someone invited me to at Columbia. And I met a sister, LaShonda Barnett, who reminded me that we improvised in the games as well, in a game song that she had learned in outside of Chicago, which was based on, I can't remember the game song right now. It's, so often the cultural opening was the dialogue between girls' games and commercial popular music. There was always a back and forth. It's very heteronormative, so there's references to Bobby Brown and to Mike Tyson and to Michael Jackson in the songs that we sing, as well as Old Aunt Dinah and Grandma, sick in bed, call the doctor, and the doctor said. So the cultural opening was the games that we have passed down from generation to generation over more than a century, if not most of the time that we've been in the Americas. So that's how I would
Thank
define
you.
The cultural opening.
I wonder if... I'm getting over a cold sinus issue. If Dr. Andreana Clay can tell us a little bit about maybe the social and political openings, and to also disrupt this heteronormativity that we might think about in studying the lives of Black girls.
Yeah, I mean, I think the one place to be looking right now is Black Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. Like the people on the front lines, the founding of the movement, the leaders of the movement are Black women and girls. Most of those people are queer identified or trans, as people talked about earlier. So I think the movement that's galvanized our attention, that's really pushing the political discourse that's happening right now around the elections, is really Black Lives Matter, and that's one place that we could be looking. And it's also, given my research, a place we, you know, should have been looking all along, in that Black women and girls of color, are really leading activist and organizing efforts in nonprofits and on the ground, grassroots organizing. It's Black women and girls' voices.
And to think that we even have to say Black Lives Matter, or we even have to think about the openings, I'm wondering if Dr. Ruth Nicole Brown could talk a bit about the silence that we've had around Black girls, and to think about what it means to then center the dialogue, center the experiences, claim the voices, and amplify them.
I've had the joy and complete utter transformation of thinking about Black girlhood for the last 10 years, collectively with a few people in this room and a lot more watching through the work of Saving Our Lives, Hear Our Truths. And so for me, I'm very much what I know about Black girlhood is grounded in our lived experiences and the collective thought and action we've put into interrogating the shit that comes at Black girls, but then also creating Black girlhood as an imaginary political space of freedom for those who come, those who bring with us, who we bring with us.
Political spaces of freedom. And as you can see, what I'm doing is activating this work here. And so I want Dr. Aimee Meredith Cox to step in now and talk a bit about how we might activate these spaces, how we might transform these spaces and think of putting Black girls at the center.
Yeah, hi everybody. Can I just first say I need to give a shout out to Joyce Ladner. Without you, we would not be here. I don't want to get choked up, but I mean that sincerely. You gave...
Yes.
Yeah. I'm sorry to not be concise, but you gave us, speaking of voices earlier, you gave me a blueprint and a voice and the courage to be able to write and explore in the ways that you laid out so beautifully so many years ago. So I want to thank you for that. Thank you. What was the question? No, I'm sorry. So I'm thinking about what Kyra said around protest and play. And then, Adriana, you were talking about Black Lives Matter. And when I think about protest and play, for example, yesterday, for those of you who were there at the gallery opening, you saw the street, a whole city block taken up with Black girls playing. And their bodies in that space was a form of protest. And so when I think about, like, in a very tangible way, what is protest and play as this intertwined thing look like? I think Black girls embody that every day. Are your occupying of spaces necessarily changes the nature of those spaces? And so when I think about how we find openings socially, I think about social institutions, whether we're talking about schools or even the family. I think about the street as a place where I've seen time and time again young Black women change the nature of those spaces. And what I mean by that, a lot of these institutions are meant to fix or transform or make Black girls into a certain type of normative, heteronormative, middle-class citizen. And I've watched Black girls from Detroit to Chicago to Cincinnati to Brooklyn turn that around and transform those spaces with their sensibilities, with their ethic of love, care, and justice. And so I think if we could look at these institutional spaces not just as how are they destructive to Black girls, how do they constrain them, but what is the work that Black girls are actually doing within those spaces to change them, to actually change policies, to change the nature of how people interact within those spaces.
And I think this is a great opening to think of the work of Dr. Toya like if we understand young people and their interactions with institutions like schools or perhaps even the justice system. And how might you show us through your work, your understanding of the ways in which Black girls have to be on guard, have to protect themselves, but also have to look to institutions for that same protection?
And I think it was articulated really well in the first panel, right? That
pull the mic.
Sorry. Yeah, let me see if I can. Okay. I think it was something that was articulated in the first panel with respect to how many young girls and Black girls in particular value the importance of education. But as was already pointed out, that they create a space for themselves even in academia across the board, right? So culturally, they become truer to themselves. I know this anecdotally in terms of my personal experience with having a 20-year-old daughter who, when she was going through middle school, because she was in a predominantly white school district at that time, just being not valued for who she was, even among some of her peers that she went to elementary school with. And out of that birthed her poetic, you know, sort of flavor, and she wore her hair natural, and she wore what she wanted to, because she took back ownership of who she was and her identity. And we certainly see that with girls in the system, right? That they have been exploited across so many dimensions, and I think the worst thing you can do to a Black girl or a Black woman is to piss her off, right? And force her to remind you who she is, right? And so what we were seeing, especially in some work that I was doing as a graduate student and even now as a faculty member, working with girls in North City, St. Louis, one of the most depressed areas of St. Louis, and seeing how girls understood the context under which they were living in terms of their victimization in their homes, their schools, their neighborhoods, and how they socially negotiated that, right? On one end, I was certainly dismayed as a parent at the time, as a Black woman who grew up in St. Louis, to know that things had only gotten progressively worse, and that girls stopped blaming schools who were supposed to protect them from mm-hmm. sexual harassment and gender harassment. They stopped blaming boys who were victimizing them because of these social hierarchies and the ways in which young men were gaining respect by disrespecting them. They stopped blaming others and took ownership of protecting themselves. So on one end, I was yay, you know, and on the other end, I was saddened, deeply mm-hmm. saddened to see that young women and girls were negotiating all the time their protection and putting forth protection mechanisms in their schools, in their homes, even in their communities, to avoid being sexually victimized. That what we found in that study was that there was a range, and this wasn't even the focus of the study, but we found that there was a range of sexual violence that these girls were experiencing, from sexual harassment early in their life course and at school all the way through to gang rapes where other kids were present and knew they were happening. Mm-hmm. And especially for the girls who have been victims of rape, that what came from that is how to protect themselves. And that was disheartening, that they had lost trust in the institutions surrounding them and even those who were supposed to be protecting them to do so. So on one end, again, elated in terms of how they were successfully navigating this, but that they were doing it solo in many respects. Mm.
So, Dr. Gaunt, can you pick up on that and think about this idea of protectiveness, but also the ways in which it has to be done, perhaps in manners that may be unconventional? And what are the consequences for how young girls have to reclaim these spaces, and what are the ways in which they try to do this?
Yeah, so I do research on... I have a collection of over 40-hour work week of twerking videos from YouTube. That got your attention.
That's a lot of work.
You're like, what? I was in my media for a second, but... and that's kind of what I'm interested in studying, because I think it has a real a big implication for what's going on with safe spaces for Black girls, Black and brown girls, transgender girls. So now that everybody has moved online and there's no double dutch in the streets, and very few girls learn hand clapping games, and there isn't that peer support that was in the neighborhood, or even in the schools, since schools don't always have recess the way they used to. Online is where people find themselves safe. So one of the safe spaces for a lot of girls is Tumblr, because you can't leave comments. Mm-hmm. And so that's why Blackout Day is so popular, I think, one of the reasons why it's so popular on Tumblr. So the research, I've collected 1,000 videos with my students, and there's the issue about space is troublesome, because people have retreated to a place where they have their personal device at home. You're in your home doing things that you love to do in your bedroom. I particularly study twerking videos from the bedroom. So that's the place where you're supposed to be safe, even though we know that people also have sexual assault and sexual violence in the home, but you're there with your personalized device, which is a mass communication tool for the first time. We had boom boxes. They have mobile webcams. So the safe space thing is very complicated, because you're doing something you love, as was said before by this brilliant, brilliant 16-year-old from Makayla. To have bodily autonomy in what you do as you're becoming of age as an adolescent, and then have people right below the video, and this is 60% of the comments below the videos are, you know, I want to put my dick in that. Mm-hmm. Why don't you take off more of your clothes in the next video? So we're giving these just horribly mixed signals to girls who are as young as 8 making these videos, to 13 who are not supposed to be on these social networking sites, mm-hmm. To girls who, my students help me collect the videos, and they can't tell the difference between what I will ask them to look for tween girls under 13, and they'll bring me a 27-year-old. Mm. So this is the mixed media age we're living in, where face-to-face communication is being dwarfed by 7,000 tweets a minute, by 300 hours of video uploaded a minute, where young girls, girls and girls of color, I don't know how they deal with the traffic that they face. So I just helped an 11-year-old girl take down a video. She lost control of her YouTube account. She had posted a video 2 years ago when she was 9 with her two cousins. It was a cute little video. They're in the bedroom twerking. And she lost control of the account. It was hacked. And because of an article that was written in Fusion.net on my research, the reporter, we went through an ACLU technologist who referred me to her. She went through my data set. It took 4 months for her to get in touch with Google to take this one video down.
Why does she want it taken down?
Because of the comments below and how the reporter found her, because I couldn't either. All of those 1,000 videos, the only person we got in touch with, YouTube is not a connecting site. People just leave comments and run, unless you're a YouTuber who blogs. So she was underneath her video defending herself. 11. So I'd say probably some data says 60% of young people will never tell their parents when something like this happens. And I was talking to my mother about, you know, when she was sexually abused when she was 7, and how she never talked about that until she was, I mean, really grown, long after. I mean, I think during my adulthood was the first time she ever talked about it. So what's going to happen to these girls online?
I want to go back to Lakeisha for your research and thinking about this element of childhood and of play and of place. Particularly thinking about the South, we're in New York City, but here we have a bit of regional variation where we can talk about how this works, perhaps looking, you know, in New Orleans versus the South Side of Chicago. So talk about these historical elements of what girlhood means and the sort of fuller elaboration of how we saw it then that maybe we can have some concrete sense of what this means now.
Well, I think that in my work on New Orleans, place is extremely important, not in just in terms of thinking about white-only spaces and then quote-unquote colored spaces, but also thinking about how black girls navigated the space of a segregated city and also what their lives meant depending on where they lived in the city, right? There are different neighborhoods that came with different amounts of privilege, but also where the look of segregation changed based on how many blacks were in that particular neighborhood, the class background of the neighborhood, the ethnic differences between African Americans in New Orleans and Afro-Creoles in New Orleans. And so all of that is the kind of spatial dynamics of the city and the landscape and the geography that black girls were navigating in their daily lives. And one of the things that I think was really important for them is as they were navigating the city, they had to figure out where they were wanted, where they were safe, and where they were allowed. And during segregation, of course, there were places where you just simply weren't allowed. But then there were other places where you just weren't safe. You weren't safe from street harassment, from white men, but also black men. You might not be safe in terms of feeling wanted. And so those kinds of issues about place are really crucial for understanding a kind of history of black girlhood. And I think reach from the past into the present, in terms of us thinking about how black girls navigate their daily lives and where they find both spaces of pleasure, but also where they deal with issues such as street harassment and sexual violence, in terms of their lives today as well.
Marcia, could you also follow up on this from your work on Chicago? I also study Chicago and the South Side, and you think about ways in which you have to navigate that city very differently depending on who you are, what you look like, what school you go to. And so these larger sort of structures are impacting the bodily movements of individuals. And so what does that mean for black girls in Chicago and perhaps New York City too?
One of the priorities of my book is to think about the ways that girlhood or black girls shaped or changed an institution that was already existing, instead of thinking of black girls during the migration as one of many migrants, right? There's no differentiation between an adult male or adult female. They're all migrants. And I think the thing that I came to in thinking about black girlhood in relationship to Chicago is that everyone has an agenda for what black girlhood is, but no one cares a lot about black girls themselves. And this is something that I pulled from growing up in the 90s. Everyone's concerned about girls on videos, but girls in everyday life, no one can be bothered. And so I think that for many African Americans during the Great Migration, girlhood was either the projection of the desire for fatherhood, so black men saying, I can finally be a man in my home and protect my daughters. Mm-hmm. I think for black women like Ida B. Wells Barnett, who we associate with anti-lynching and suffrage, she was one of the first people to say, we're not going to do this to black girls. So she saw their presence as changing what the standard of a community is. If Chicago is going to be a real innovative place for black people to be free, then we're going to bring our girls front and center in that. And it's amazing to be able to go to the historical archive and appreciate Ida B. Wells even more, if you can imagine. And I think the last thing in terms of what the city meant for black girls, it was testing the same limits that their parents were testing. And I think that experience is very unusual for us to understand, that girls are drinking, they're meeting boys on the street, they're buying clothes for the first time. They're expressing an independence that they didn't have in the South, but they're also watching their parents do it at the same time, and it's kind of ruining it for them. And what happens is that the girls are critiquing the parents and saying, why aren't you going to church anymore? And who are you talking to over there? You're not married to him, you're not married to her. And so I think that it helps us appreciate just how transformative the migration was, not only in terms of numbers, but in experiences and subjectivity.
Mm. I want to sing my girl song from
migration. Wait, Kyra, I want to get to. Oh Aimee, you think about some of these same issues when we think about claiming space and the role of girlhood in shaping one's assessment of who they are and who they project to the world. Can you talk more about the work you've done with young girls?
Yeah, so people tell me I'm so bad at promoting my book, so here it is. It's awesome. Called Shapeshifters, awesome. Black Girls and the Choreography of Citizenship. And it's based on really, 8 years of field work with young women in a homeless shelter in Detroit, Michigan. Young women between the ages of 15 and 21. And it took 10 years to do that research and another 10 years to rewrite the dissertation, almost, basically. It feels like it. But what I was interested in, to be honest, I'm a cultural anthropologist, and unlike sociologists, and Carla, you can correct me if I'm wrong, we, at least where I studied, there wasn't a lot of intentional focus on the methodology. You were kind of like, oh, what's interesting to you? What's the site you want to look at? Which is kind of good, because you go in not with a preformed question. And so I knew that in a very broad way, I wanted to figure out why black girls were so fly, right? Especially black girls who, if you look at all of the things that are stacked against them, in this case, they're homeless, many of them single parents, black, poor, beyond poor, living in a beleaguered city, Detroit. And I wondered what it would mean like to be, in many ways, constructed so far from a center, right? And all of these concentric circles so far from a center, how do you navigate the world? How do you transform your life such that it's not always about pain and tragedy and struggling through, but what are the joys, what are the ways that black girls create and not just respond to the world? Mm-hmm. So I went in with that very open question, and I ended up becoming the shelter director while I was conducting this research, which enabled me to write a different sort of book. So this isn't about a big bad institution and how they, you know, do wrong to black girls. It was really about the class and racial and gender dynamics within that shelter institution and how the young women interacted with the shelter staff and transformed that space. So it wasn't about the institution is here and the girls are here, which is what we often get in ethnographic studies of social institutions. It was about the intermingling of space and identity, and in this case, black girls. And so what happened within that shelter space was not much different from what happened to these girls outside of the shelter. And so even though I was talking about or writing about or writing with homeless girls, this is very much a book about home. So if you can imagine, even though these young women, for the most part, I would say about 87% of the young women who came to the shelter found themselves homeless because their auntie's house, their grandmother's house became overcrowded with grown men, toddlers. At one point, Bessie's grandmother I write about, there was from a 3-year-old to a 50-year-old man, 17 people living in the home, and the young black woman is always the first person asked to leave. You'll be all right, right? You're cute, you can figure it out, there's services for you. And so what's astounding to me in this work is how those young women in this city space and even in this home space where they're left unprotected, their primary ethic was to take care of other people. Mm-hmm. They would be working jobs at Forever 21 and Cinnabon and giving the money back to their mothers and their uncles, right? We'd be riding in the shelter van and they're worried about the young black men on the street. And I'm like, you're home, you know what I mean? So this ethic of care, though, translated into the ways that they transform that shelter space. So I'll just wrap up by saying, for example, this is just a tangible policy transformation that these girls enacted. When young women moved out of the shelter, traditionally they were given relocation assistance in the form of, you know, to be able to buy furniture, to get paid first month's rent. But that was given if you were moving out on your own. And this is the question of family, the disruption of the family that Joyce Ladner writes so beautifully about in a different form, right? And so you were given money. Imagine that. You're given assistance if you are moving out by yourself or with someone, a man you intend to marry or that you're married to. So these young women had created in the space of this shelter relationships and friendships with other young women. And they're like, why can't Ruth, Nicole and Marcia, we're friends. We take care of each other's children. We help each other with our family issues. We should be able to all move out together into a space and get 3 times the relocation assistance. But what they did in that policy change was redefine the way that social institutions, the shelter, defined family, defined care, defined protection, and defined really love. And they said, this is love, right? And so that ethic of family that happened in a homeless shelter is just really, really fascinating to me. For young women who were not protected, their main concern was how they could protect.
Toya, could you follow up on that in thinking of these larger institutions or different institutions and how black girls' agency may have shown through? And then I want to get to Ruth and Nicole and talk a little bit about celebration because yes. Toya is our criminologist. We sort of walk these same paths and it gets depressing when we're talking about some of this stuff. But we have to go across the continuum in thinking of care and of safety. And so what do these other institutions do to allow for or perhaps to make it so that young girls have to fight through showing their agency and making things that make sense for them make sense?
I got to piggyback off of what Aimee just shared. I'll hold it. thank you. What Aimee just said in terms of how they redefine institutions and how to navigate them and really affect change and the sad part for me, I guess, in terms of working with and studying young girls is that they are doing this with very little resources, mm-hmm. right, besides themselves and looking out and protecting themselves. So, like, for instance, protecting their sexual identity, that one way in which you could predict that girls were going to have an issue or fight was because of their reputation and protecting their sexual reputation because they knew that opened them up to everything from sexual harassment mm-hmm. from other boys all the way through to being victims of acquaintance rape. So again, even the most dire situations, and at this point I was interviewing girls at an alternative school, that mm-hmm. even in the most dire situations, they were figuring out ways to be cohesive, to protect each other. They would also look out for other girls, you know, girls who were susceptible to victimization at the hands of boys. They would look out for that girl, but they were also very, very much so pushing away girls that they thought were willing participants and mm-hmm. laughing off, for instance, sexual harassment. So they really, really worked hard to figure out how to protect themselves, how to insulate themselves from these practices that were commonplace in their school, in their communities, even in their homes. And I got to put in this one little dig. even as a criminologist, I value the importance of ethnographic research, right? That we've had some really foundational people that have set the standard for us in terms of not going in with the research question per se. And I was so fortunate to get training in qualitative and quantitative research, and understanding that the qualitative research is where, and that I appreciate probably all the more, is because they tell me their stories, right? Mm-hmm. And then I look for themes and patterns across. And unfortunately, what we're finding is just what was articulated here and before, that for young Black girls in particular, and Black women, that they are essentially creating agency and space in places that they are locked out of. They are creating their, they are really pushing forward with respect to identity. Someone mentioned earlier about the Black Lives Matters movement and how that really has been, Black girls have been at the forefront of that, and especially college students, right? And this is very, very parallel to the civil rights movement, right? And those foundational women who were a part of that, like Diane Nash, who you never hear about very often, right? That's young people and young women of color, and Black women in particular, have always been at the forefront of these issues and always identifying ways in which to not only protect themselves, but even those that might not even look out for them, right? And so I think that's been really foundational in terms of researching crime and justice.
Yes, and as Ruth Nicole gets her answer together, and when she tells us about her vision for saving our lives, hear our truths, I want all of you to think about your questions. I want to get some index cards. I want to take a few questions from the floor from our girls in the room especially, and get some live stream questions going. So think of your questions, write them down, and we'll come back to that. So Ruth Nicole, tell us more about this vision.
So it's interesting what happens. It is interesting what happens when you have organized with Black girls and Black women to create a space that is for Black girls. And that's what I enjoy writing about. Everything, when you do that work, it's the gamut. Right now, talk about heartbreak, because when you organize with people, heartbreak is very much a part of the story. Black girl heartbreak, I know very well. I also know that when you have homegirls who can love you back, and we do this work and we think collectively so that my ideas become our ideas, and what is this we thing that we're thinking about, and is Black girlhood always, we're always pushing ourselves to make sure it's inclusive as possible. And what do we mean when we say Black girlhood? Because for me, it's very important to think about Black girlhood collectively, creatively, artistically, which means because it's artistic and creative, it's therefore intellectual, always. Mm. and what, how then, you know, because he, how then, what actions does that provoke when we're asking these questions? How do we need to change the set design? That's what we do in Soul Hot. We change the set design so that Black girlhood is always within our reach. It always has to be something that looks like this is for us too. So you have the twerkers and the prayers and all the, as the song goes. And we make our own, period.
Andreana, can you follow up on this and thinking about queerness and difference, as was stated as something as the next frontier for acceptance of difference? And how does this manifest in terms of thinking of Black girls and their role at the center of the most amazing social movement and you know, that I can think of?
Yeah. If I can just say really quickly, I'm about to burst. Like, I know, every time I come to the mic, I try to be really cool, but I've never been on a panel where I can actually look out and see what we're seeing on this panel. I mean, it's enough to be on this panel, but I just had to say that. And I think one question you asked before from me was about identity and how identity matters in these movements. And I think it is central to how we think about this movement, Black Lives Matter in particular, and how black queer women, black trans men, black trans women, black gender queer folks are really shaping the discourse around this movement, that those identities matter in terms of, I think what Monique was saying earlier about how this freedom struggle is articulated, like it's never separate. And I think for black girls in particular and black women, we have to think about how black women, black queer folks, black trans folks are articulating those identities, because it's different. I mean, if you look in mainstream media or in mainstream organizations, no LGBT organization has backed the efforts of Black Lives Matter publicly, has never once sort of supported the efforts of Black Lives Matter. There was a point where over the summer, and I'm studying this right now and interviewing black queer and trans folks in Black Lives Matter, so I've been really attentive to this. There was a point where like The Advocate or another mainstream organization sort of looked back at Huey Newton's famous speech. Well, they said they uncovered it, but if you like scratch the surface, you'll find this speech where he said to our revolutionary black women and queer and gay brothers, and he talked about how homosexuals may be the most revolutionary, right? So there was this big celebration of Huey Newton and how he said these things in 1970, and not one mention of the fact that the founders, who are often recognized of Black Lives Matter, are two of them are queer women, right? Or that the people on the front lines in almost every city are queer black women, right? So it always exists separately. So we have to actually listen and understand how black, queer, and trans folks are articulating their identities. Like just quickly, people that I've interviewed have said, you know, I am a black queer femme, or I am a black stud, or I identify as black gender queer, but I'm transitioning to, and those things matter. Like it's not identity politics, it's not separate from how we live our everyday lives, and it's not separate for how we are on those front lines.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I want to open the floor for questions. We have, you know, such an amazing panel here. I don't think my cards went around, so you are going to have to ask an actual question. I'm known for being a little hardcore in my classes at Columbia. I want you to ask an actual question. I'm going to have a wonderful assistant who will take the mic around for you to ask that question and give it back to the audience.
And can I just remind people that we have a few young people in the room.
So,
we've
yes.
been talking qualitative and quantitative. Be inclusive with your language.
So question one, I want to hear from some of the young girls in the room. I saw it over there. And raise your hand so I can find you and look you. Okay. Claim it. You got it.
Thank you, all of you. My question is for Professor Gaunt. Could you sing your song, please? Is that a real question? It's a real question.
No, you guys had to help me, because, you know, girls don't do solo songs.
All right, sing a song.
I'm going up north, your part is easy. Satisfied, and this is totally a migration. It's from the 1950s, recorded in East Alabama. So it's, I'll sing. I'm going up north, satisfied. Satisfied, that's all you gotta do.
Satisfied,
I'm going up north.
Satisfied,
some people up there.
Satisfied,
gonna bring you back.
Satisfied,
mama cooked a chicken.
Satisfied,
daddy cooked a bull.
Satisfied,
mama gone on.
Satisfied,
I'm going up north.
Satisfied,
I'm going up north.
Satisfied,
I'm going up north.
Satisfied,
mama cooked a chicken.
Satisfied,
daddy cooked a bull.
Satisfied.
Ain't nothing up there.
Satisfied.
Gonna bring you back.
Satisfied.
Okay, whenever I do this with white folks, they, you know, it rushes on. And I was at a conference for white feminists, you know, all of the feminist musicologists, and I was able to teach them about how there's a different aesthetic. You know, there's just
here,
a whole
we have a
aesthetic.
Q&A though.
So no. I'm just letting you know, like I'm serious, because as a scholar, it's just really important to me. And I think, you know, Ruth, Nicole and I, like the work that we, and Aimee too, the work that we do is embodied, you know, and how I learn about my research is through the embodied practice and social practice that I do. So thank you for
beautiful
that.
Beautiful song. I'm quite satisfied. Next question.
So the panel, just amazing. I'm looking at the names and what you studied. I'm just blown away. I want to know, what advice would you give to emerging scholars, and how did you figure out what you're passionate about? Like, I'm all over the place. One day I want this. I work with incarcerated youth, so I'm over here. How do I center everything?
Okay, great. I'm going to ask Toya to speak to that, and Aimee.
I'm going to be honest with you and say, don't center it, right? Yeah. So I came in to my grad to undergrad, my working on my bachelor's degree as a pre-law major. And at the time, we were heavily advised to take classes in political science. I wanted to take political science courses like I wanted a hole in my head. but I was moved. I had taken, as a social science requirement, intro to criminology and criminal justice. And that changed me. I was so intrigued and so enthralled with what I was learning in that class. And so by my junior year, switched my major, by my junior year, I took juvie justice. And I went to, in the class, we did a tour of the facility, and they allowed a young man who was there to do the tour. And I found out through the course of that he was a sex offender, you know, what we would call a sex offender. But I saw so much hope and promise there, in that the director of the Juvenile Justice Center said, no, this young man needs to give the tour. So I'm like, great, this is a system I can work in where, you know, young men and young men of color are not marginalized in the way they are in the adult system. Well, got my world shaken up and changed when I took statistics in criminal justice. And I had done well in the class, and my professor said, have you thought about research? And I had, right? I was thinking about justice system practices and where I fit in and where I could be the most effective. And she introduced me to a whole other world of research on victimization. And from there, I went straight into my doctoral program. Now, I won't advocate that, right, because I didn't know what I was getting into. I was first-generation college student. But I went straight from my bachelor's to my doctoral program, which was awesome. But even there, learning to direct my path, that people weren't asking the types of research questions I was asking or interested in that. And so I would say, don't center. Be as wide open and as thoughtful across this space as you can. Certainly, I mean, we know in academia, white students, especially if you teach at a predominantly white institution like I do, they change their majors all the time, right? with no recourse for that. And I have students who take my classes over and over again who are unfortunately, taking this class again, but they don't really care necessarily because they have the financial support to retake classes and to figure it out even while they're there. So I would say, don't lose your agency. Don't lose your voice and become tracked. Have some ideals, but then follow your path where it leads you.
Aimee, can you speak to your...
I'll be really brief. I would just say that, first of all, thank you for the question, and I totally agree. Stay curious. You don't have to choose. Stay curious, stay open, stay loving, stay courageous. When I started my doctoral research, it was very, very, very difficult for me to put a committee together. No one wanted to touch it. And so, but I'm so glad that I believed in my work enough to just finish. I mean, I think if you're not researching, if you're not curious, if you're not writing from a place of passion, then you're recreating some of the same systems and ideas and theories that you intentionally started out with trying to dismantle. So I think if you can just stay loving, stay courageous, stay open, that's really the best advice I can give right now.
Next question, thank you. You have the mic.
Okay. Hi, I'm Destiny. I'm a junior at Princeton, and I'm from St. Louis. So.
Yay.
And my question is, how, in like telling the stories of Black girls, or I guess like transcribing the stories that we tell and they tell for themselves, what are some of the ways that you all might suggest avoiding representing Black girls as just like these passive victims who everything happens to and who like we just like allow things to happen to, right? Because like Black girls are also people with agency. But at the same time, avoiding giving Black girls so much agency because we also see the harms of thinking of Black girls as way more mature than they are, mm-hmm. and as perceiving them as women. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Okay. Marcia, can you speak to that?
I think that you have to, in any story about black girls, understand there's dimension. And I think that, you know, one of the dangers in teaching an African-American history is that people start to think, well, do black people have joy? And you're like, of course. But then they're like, well, where is it documented? I want to see it. And so I think that we are in a moment in which scholars are able to show the complexity of black life, and they're not worried about alienating people from it, because I think there was a period of time where any cultural production that involved black people had to be painful, and that was it. And I think this is why I love Black Lives Matter so much, because one of the organizing principles is both is anger, is creativity, is, you know, protest can look like a lot of things. It can be an art installation, it can be a die-in. And so I think that complexity, we see it in the work. And so in my book, it was really important for me to show moments where girls are actually doing things like camping. We have a radical monarch in the audience, and I was trying to find an opening for that, but you know, that's part of a very long, I just think it's so cool, but I think it's part of a really long history of black women advocating for black girls to play and seeing that as equally important as access to schools. You know, civil rights and integration happen in a number of spaces, and we focus on the battleground of school, but so many black women understood the importance of getting their girls the swim lessons and the camping trips and, you know, all of these different things. And so we are now in a moment where we can retrain our brains to see that, and I think it's because of the work of the women on this panel.
Andreana, you're
to get us. No, I just was really feeling that question, because you bump up against it anytime you try and write about young people of color, especially black girls, and I've written about Latina girls. Like, you always have to contend with what's out there from your publisher, from your advisor, from your colleagues. Why haven't you talked about this? And it's usually like, you know, teen pregnancy or whatever it is. And as an ethnographer, I felt like it was really important to highlight the voices of the young women, like just use their voices. Like, if you ever question about how to present, fall back on, you know, the interviews, the participant observation, the focus groups, whatever it is that you use as your method as putting out their voices. And that, I mean, it took so long to write the book just because I was trying to navigate that and navigate it in a way that was honest and not sort of falling. I mean, how do you describe the physical attributes, you know, like what somebody looks like physically in a book that as academics will likely be read mostly by white people, you know, like thinking about those things, taking the time to do that and falling back on their own words, I think is the richest thing.
Thank you. Over here.
First, I want to thank you all for giving me life. Like, so much life was given in the past, like, hour. So thank you so much for the work that y'all do. And I am currently a freshman at Harvard College. And trying to navigate that space as a black woman is definitely very hard. And also trying to get into the work of academia and making sure that literature is around black girls is very difficult. So my question to you all is, how do you continue to push back at a predominantly white institution that tells you that the voice of black girls doesn't really matter and everything's fine with them, so just to stop what you're doing? And also, I do this work anyway, I don't care what they say, but at the same time, it becomes difficult to keep doing this work because it's my stories out there as well, and I see a lot of myself when I do this research as well. So how do you find time to heal from the stories that you hear? Because we have our own trauma as well. And we have to make sure that we identify our own trauma before we push that on other people and not have that reflect upon the work in which we want to celebrate the humanity and the perfection that is black girls.
Lakeisha, can you hit that?
It's a difficult question. I think on the one hand, when I was in graduate school, I went to graduate school at the University of Michigan, and I went to undergrad at the University of Virginia. And I found people there who supported me. And if it's just one professor, if it's just a group of students who you can talk to about your ideas, you know, you need that. And I had that, and I was lucky enough to have that in both of my spaces. But then the other thing is that I feel very strongly that I have inherited so much as a black woman scholar. Mm-hmm. And part of that is the women who came before me, who were the first generation of black women scholars in the academy. I could not exist without them as a professional, and this book that I wrote wouldn't exist without the Black women historians who came before me. The book is called Crescent City Girls. But Darlene Clark Hine and my advisor, Michelle Mitchell, and just a number of Black women scholars who paved the way for me. And so in some ways, my answer is, think about those people who are paving the way for you, and if you need to reach out to some, but also just follow in their footsteps. And then the other thing I would say about trauma, I think it's, that's a really difficult question. And I in my book, I talk about a Black girl in the 1930s who was killed by an off-duty police officer. I talk about Black girls and sexual violence, and having navigated my own traumas as an adolescent Black girl, like many of us here. It's something that you're always working through, but sometimes in telling the traumatic stories, you're also able to kind of come to terms with what's happened to you in the past and to your friends and to your family members. And so it's kind of recognizing that the history of racial violence is a long history that we're always kind of in a reckoning with. But it's important for us to kind of tell those stories. And so for me, the way that I handle the kind of trauma about writing about this stuff is by thinking about the importance of telling those stories and then trying to move forward and also looking for those spaces of pleasure and joy.
Thank you. I'm gonna get this question over here, and we have another one over there.
Hello.
How are
Hi.
You?
Hi.
As a queer of color college student, I would like to know, how do you deal with pushback and resistance from like heterosexual spaces, and or the new notion like the Black homophobia or transphobia, especially in your scholarly work in academia?
Let's see. It was kind of a mixture personally of people backing off and leaving me alone, which is not useful, right? But because people didn't have the language or didn't think about Black queer girls in my research on youth activists, you know, they thought, first they didn't think of girls at all. Like, the activist frame is male, right? And we think of activists as young men. And so to think about Black queerness or queer girls of color or queer trans men, people didn't know what to do with that. So for, so I was kind of left alone. So to forge those other spaces, I found lots of other queer women of color in academia, and creating that sort of space and doing different panels and writing together collectively has been one strategy that's been life-saving in academia, I have to say. And but I can't believe I don't know how to answer this question. it's kind of that mix, like finding your own space. And you know, every time you go into a space that's not specifically queer and you think about presenting on it or saying, you know, I am a member of this group as well, or this is what I did and this is why I'm so passionate about it, it's, you think about it, right? Like, it's at the forefront of how you're going to be received and how you're going to be, what kinds of questions you're going to get, and regularly told that essentially you don't know what you're talking about because you're so limited in your focus, not thinking that Black queer women means Blackness, or it means women, or it means queerness, right?
And I like that we can think of the words disruption that could lead to an interruption of what we think is normative and change those spaces just by being there. So we have to disrupt. We have to be disrespectful, as Michaela said in the first panel, to even get people to see us and to understand us. Question.
Hi, I too would like to just echo the thank yous. Thank you so much, panelists, for being here and for giving us your knowledge and your wisdom. My question is geared toward the Black Lives Matter movement, and the question is geared to everyone, whoever would like to answer. But have you received any pushback for your stance with the Black Lives Matter? Because what I've noticed is I, for one, am really excited about the movement, along with a large community. But right not too long after Black Lives Matter was born, there was also another platform that was brought to life, which was All Lives Matter. And you know, when you take a stance for Black Lives Matter and you get pushback for standing up for Black Lives Matter, you know, my question for you is, how has your argument been? How did you support your decision to support Black Lives Matter and not to turn your back on that and join All Lives Matter? How has your approach been with that?
Great question. Toya.
Okay, so
use your mic.
I'm so glad that you asked that question, because what I've seen essentially happen, even in my experience as, so I'm a graduate of the University of Missouri system. And so we have the four campuses, and everybody's familiar with our main campus, Mizzou. But I mean, the level of isolation for Black students on those campuses is amazing. And so now as a faculty member, I actually developed a course, Blackness is Threat, hashtag Black Lives Matter, hashtag Hands Up Don't Shoot, hashtag, right, we added all the hashtags. And I'll be honest, the reason I was able to do that is because I'm a tenured professor now, right? And that I sort of gradually worked into that. And from that, you know, having students well receive it, even developing a course pre-tenure on race, class, and justice, so we could talk about these systems within a predominantly white institution, one that I was a graduate of and one now with reservation was a faculty member of. And so what happened during the course of this time that I developed this course was the situation that everyone is probably familiar with that happened at Mizzou. And to have students, Black students, say they weren't allowed to go and protest with students at our sister campus by faculty, right? That even if they didn't agree with the movement, the fact that this was an eyesore for the university, but they weren't allowed to. They were not allowed to turn in work early or come back and make up that work, even though it was really important. And so what that spawned, again, the worst thing you can do is piss off Black female students and tell them no, is now developing a chapter for UMKC, the University of Missouri, Kansas City, trying to work hard at developing a chapter of Black Lives Matter on our campus. And a lot of that came from the frustrations that they were experiencing, seeing that the university, in terms of PR, was very much so behind, we need to do something, but in terms of actual outcomes, weren't. And so it mobilized students on my campus and in our community, given, you know, I'm from St. Louis, many of the students at the Kansas City campus are from St. Louis, and we're devastated because these were communities that we grew up in. We have family members that are still there, friends that are still there, and yet their voice is being stifled. But they became very visible and active on campus, and so a lot of pushback, I'll be frank in that, but at the same time, I see a lot of push forward, too, among the students. Mm.
Question? Yeah. Hello, my name is Angel. I am a graduate of Howard University, and I'm currently completing my master's at the University of Pennsylvania, and I'm strongly considering PhD study. And so my question is closely related with the young lady before me, specifically asking about these types of consequences Black women specifically incur when they pursue activism while also wanting to pursue a tenure track or tenured professor position. So my question is, basically, I know you mentioned you're already a tenured professor, but for people who are looking to attain that, but also are trying to balance that with their activism and possible consequences they could receive from the university, do you have any advice or words of encouragement or ways to, I guess, mitigate those things? Thank you.
Marcia? I mean, I'll say, so I got very active in the conversation around Ferguson right before I went up for tenure. And one of the things that you just, every person, regardless of what your job is, what your role is, you make a decision about the consequences. And I don't think that we're any different because we're professors. And we have to really honor that because people make those choices. But I think that one thing that I always advise my students, if you're honest and clear, there's only so much things that people can do to you, but you have to be both. And so I was not publicly saying anything that was not true, and I was just being very honest about a situation that was happening. And so one of the things but you also have to know that we do this in community, and so there will be a limit that you personally will feel like, you know what, I cannot go there, but I know that the people in my squad, this person will go there on my behalf. And I think it takes a lot of pressure off of you as an individual, and it makes your activism feel less high stakes all the time and more, you know, gratifying, because you're not doing this by yourself. And everyone has a choice to make, and I don't think anyone's ever in a position to judge how far you went or if you didn't go far enough. But I think the more you build community, the more you get the confidence to do it, because you see that this is a job. This is not the best thing about me or anybody else on this panel that we're tenured professors. Mm. That's probably like the least interesting things about us. I think what is most interesting is our ability to connect with a population that may feel like higher ed is a foreign land, and we can make it more familiar to them.
And to wrap up, I want to have each of our panelists, I asked you in advance, to think of your big idea word. What word would represent something that if you center the lives and the experiences of Black girls, what would change about our understanding of that word? And I just want to go down the line from Kyra on down to think about, tell us what your big word is and how you plan to capture or push that word forward in your next steps of work.
My big word is sexploitation, online sexploitation, around ethics and invisible audiences who need to learn how to honor and respect people, to use a phrase from the earlier panel, that are different than them when they see people they don't actually know in person, online.
That's great.
They may never be in a Black girl's bedroom, but they can watch their videos online and to learn how to have honor and respect for people you don't know.
Sexploitation, ethics, respecting difference. Toya?
My one word is empowerment. That even though sometimes I'm interviewing girls or working in some where they're at their worst moments, what they always teach me and what I always understand is empowerment. So empowerment is my word. That girls in the system, girls outside of the system, and again, they remind me all the time of who I am, and how empowered I was, even when I didn't think I was, right? And so empowerment is certainly a thing that has been thematic in my research, thematic in my personal life, thematic in terms of how I engage the academy, and using my tenure status to protect the girls who want to have that level of empowerment. So empowerment would be my word.
Thank you. Lakeisha?
I think that one word my research engages with is childhood. And thinking about when you center Black girls, you see that Black girls are often not afforded a childhood that includes innocence, that includes girlhood. And in my work, I talk about how white segregationists never saw Black girls, as children, who deserved a certain kind of protection. And also we see, you know, because there is so much trauma, we see Black girls having to grow up so fast. And at the art exhibit, Lauren Shea's work on Rakia Boyd was so fabulous. And she was up there saying that she had to do this work, that it could have been her. And I was, you know, proud of her and heartbroken, right? That she had to do this work. And she's a girl, you know? And so in my work, there's stories like this. One girl who was killed by the off-duty police officer, another girl wrote into W.E.B. Du Bois and said, when is someone going to stop this? This is always happening to us. Mm. And so just that idea that that Black girls deserve a childhood, they deserve a period of innocence and play, just like other children.
Thank you. Childhood, yes.
I think I said sexuality, but I would tweak it and say queer. Queer has always been such an important word for me as someone who came out as queer in the 90s and just identified with it, but it's always read as sort of white. And if you center Black girls or Blackness, like you tweak that incredibly. Like it's so much more, it's always been for me and with young women that I see, it's so much more than sexuality or lesbian or gay or whatever. It's Blackness and its full womanhood and its femininity or its stud or whatever it is, like just I can't wait to do more of that.
Queerness, yes, Ruth Nicole.
I want you all to know and remember Karen Washington. There is no greater joy than collectively working together to make power and to celebrate ourselves as Black girls and women. And as we say in Soul Hot, Black girls been queer, we been here.
Right, celebrate.
I would say theory. I think we have this idea that you need a PhD or you need an advanced degree to theorize. We all theorize. By the nature of being alive and navigating this world, we have to create ideas about ourselves and the world that we live in. And so in terms of Black girls, rather than using theorists to understand their lives, I'm hoping that we can flip that paradigm and use the theorizations of Black girls to understand the world.
Mm. Theory.
I would say joy. Black girls are really funny, and I think Twitter is all the evidence you need. I think that there's always a question, how do you do this work? I do this work because there's a lot of laughter that happens with my students in the classroom and with the girls I get to meet in history. They're just so funny, and so I think we have to remember that.
All right, so we have sexploitation, we have empowerment, we have childhood, we have queerness, we have remembrance, we have theory, and we have joy.
Black feminism and community.
We have so many words, we have so many ideas. Mine would be to think about the legacy, to think about that which has been given to us and that which we will leave behind. I am so amazed to be a part of this conference and of the women who made it happen and to bring you these women and all of their work. Thank you for joining us. Thank Farrah.
Turn that fall into not quite a twerk, but we'll see. Thank you so much to this wonderful panel and to Carla Shedd for pulling it all together. Thank you to you all. We're going to reconvene at 2:45 with a panel on best practices for Black girls, moderated by Joanne Smith. So go grab some tea or something and then come back. Don't stay too long. Thank you.